Trevor striking, not to mention consoling, that already in the Hebrew scriptures, as we see in the first reading today, God speaks to the whole people as his son. Ephraim is my firstborn, since I'm a father to Israel. It comes up a number of other times in the prophets, for example, Hosea, towards the end of Hosea. It says, out of Egypt, I called my son. That's referring to the Exodus, calling them out of Egypt. But that's the very line that's quoted in the Gospel of Matthew, beginning of the Gospel of Matthew. Speak about the flight into Egypt and then the return. It's quoted, out of Egypt, called my son. Meaning, of course, Jesus. But that's the trouble in a sense. We tend to think only of Jesus as the Son of God. Whereas already in the Hebrew scriptures, we have more than that. The whole people, God's children, God's beloved Son, firstborn. And of course, that's what we should be believing about ourselves as well. That we are the beloved children of God. We're created in His image, we're baptized, we receive His Spirit, we're Christified, and we should be able to exalt and be faithful to, exalt in and be faithful to that identity as a child of God. So the same way in the second reading, when it speaks about Jesus not taking this honor for himself and being high priest, well, we don't take this honor for ourselves either. We're called by God, as Jesus was and is, to quote the reading. So when it says there too, quoting Psalm 2, the second Psalm, you are my son, this day I have begotten you. Again, it doesn't just apply to Jesus. Well, that's what they're talking about in the letter to the Hebrews. And we've used that verse at the Christmas Midnight Mass for centuries and centuries to refer, of course, to Jesus as the beloved begotten, the only begotten of God. This day I have begotten you. But it does also apply to each one of us. He says to each one of us, every day, this day, not just the day of your baptism, but every day, this day I have begotten you. I beget you as my daughter and my son today. Plus, being high priest, we're all called by the same baptism that makes us children of God. We are called to be priests, prophets, and kings. That messianic psalm, Psalm 2, was originally applied to the king. Well, we're all called to be priests, prophets, and kings. We're all called to be children of God and to live that wonderful message. And that gives us strength and hope, the solidity, energy to be able to cope with our daily trials and our daily obligations, with laughter and tears, to use the image of the psalm. And in the first reading too, where it says, they went forth in tears, they'll come back rejoicing. Actually, it's a better translation there to say they'll come back. Because there can be tears of joy too, right? So tears, all the tears of our lives, the joys, the sorrows, all the struggles of our lives, we can meet them with courage and hope because we are children of God, we have His Spirit, and we're able to live in and live and as Christ in the world. And in fact, the very next line of the letter to the Hebrews in this chapter 5 that we read today says that in the days of his flesh he offered loud cries and tears to God. And he was heard because of his reverence. In other words, even Jesus, or especially Jesus, as he represents all of us and takes on all our sufferings and fears and tears, not only does he, but all of us, are going to have loud cries and tears to God. And face the many struggles and joys of life as well. The more that we When I was a kid, we always taught to say the morning offering, where we offer precisely my action and sufferings and joys of this day. So that's where the priesthood comes in. That's where we're all priests. We offer up to God each moment, this day in which we're begotten. We're offering all our sufferings and our trials and our joys and all our actions, which we can do and hopefully will do. As children of God, in that infinite dignity and that marvelous privilege and that immeasurable joy of being his firstborn, of being his And then we should be able to act that way. In other words, recognizing that dignity in all. Yesterday, I was contemplating about nature in Boston. I gave a lecture on a book by Beatrice Rousseau called God's Ecstasy, about creating a self-creating world. And her view of sin, I think, is a very good witness. It's the failure to recognize God's presence. She says the ground of being. We can say, if you prefer, the presence of God in everyone and everything, especially everyone, all our brothers and sisters who are God's beloved children, created in His image. So sin is, that's very accurate. It's the failure to recognize and respect that image of God, that beloved, that dignity as beloved children of God, and all of our brothers and sisters, Christian or not, all created in God's image, are all called to be brothers and sisters in the human race, and ultimately in the family of God. Failure to recognize and respect that dignity in others. But she adds, and this is especially insightful, I think, and perceptive, that in turn comes from the failure to recognize it in ourselves. That's what has to start. That's what I'm talking about today. Really love your neighbor as yourself. Well, if you don't recognize yourself as a beloved child of God, not going to treat other people as beloved children of God, woman by woman, either. So it does have to start here. Recognizing this irreplaceable dignity and joy and privilege of being children of God. And then we can treat others the same way. But if we don't have that security, that identity, and that assurance, we're going to try to find our security and our identity and our assurance in other things. Escaping into money or power or pleasure or whatever it might be to find an anchor and a security for ourselves. Who am I? What am I doing in this world? How can I find some kind of joy? Well, you won't need to do all that if you find your peace. Inadmissible, that's, you can't lose it. Remember, we're called by God. It's not something we can achieve, or that we have to achieve, or we can gain or acquire. You're already and forever children of God, so relax. Or no, be enthused about living that, out in the world. And people who live as children of God and recognize the dignity of the children of God in everyone, they don't fly planes in the buildings. They don't send pipe bombs in the mail. They don't make people work as slaves on sugar plantations, as we have in our world at times today. And that's thousands and thousands of examples of the horrible cruelty and exploitation. Hatred, fear comes from not recognizing your dignity and then not recognizing that. So we really do need to be, not just believe it, what good is that? Experience it, live it. In deep prayer, really assume your dignity, feel your dignity, live your dignity, be conscious of your dignity. And that will give you the light to be able to perceive the dignity of children of God and everyone. So, that's the meaning of the gospel today, I think. We're all blind, sitting begging, if we don't see and perceive and experience who we really are. That's the primordial illusion and blindness, not recognizing our infinite, irreplaceable, eternal dignity as children of God, finding our identity and security there. So we should be sitting by the roadside begging, crying out in tears, so that they would have mercy on me. And then hopefully they'll say, He's calling me. Well, He is calling me. We're all called by God, as Jesus was, to assume this dignity, this reality of ourselves. And then Jesus asks, what do you want? Well, good question. What do you want? Well, let's hope we ask for that. That I may see who I really am. See who everyone really is. See what the world really is, overflowing with abundance and the presence of God, and treating even the environment with dignity because it's got God's presence and that crown. And then we follow him along the way as the blind man, no longer blind, thus at the end of the gospel. We follow along the way, which of course is Jesus is the way. So we live out with him and in him and as him, if you will, our dignity as children of God as well. This day I am beginning you. This day I am continuing to beget the whole universe. In Christ, and as Christ, and through Christ, whom all is created, all is redeemed. The whole universe is his body, cosmic Christ. So we are all connected. We are all God's beloved children in him. We need to treat ourselves first of all, and all of it, with that magnificent dignity that we have in all.